Genau, ja, das sind.
Genau, das ist immer.
Ja, so Leute.
Department at Apollo Hospitals, BGNO. So this talk is intended for beginners and technologists, where I will be speaking basic, will be speaking on basics of complete blood culture, peripheral smear. Can you see the smear? Slide.
Yes,
ma'am. Yeah, let me get it. So coming to the topic now, complete blood count. So what is it? Why is it done? How is it done? And what are the components? So all of us should remember that within a small corner in the laboratory, we play a very important and critical part in bringing about positive change in public health. We are the persons who are going to provide the right report at right time so that the patient gets the right treatment in time. So we will start from the beginning. So we have to do the collection first. So the blood sample collection for CBC is the EVPA vacutainers. Better to go for vacutainers. You can use non-vacuum blood tubes, but they will have lot of errors, so go for vacutainers. You can use whole capillary blood or the venous blood, commonly is the venous blood from the antithrombotic vein or anywhere else. You can go for the venous blood. 3 ml of EDTA vacutainers are commonly used. If the tests are more, you can go for 6 ml or 12 ml, and if it is a baby, you can go for microvacutainers also. So once the sample is drawn, and also remember to tell your technicians to collect the sample in the order of draw. Always follow the order of draw.
Ja.
other points, that is labeling or barcoding of the sample is very essential. After the barcoding is done, you need to check the quantity, whether adequate quantity of blood is collected. Then mixing has to be done. Then look for any clots and rule out any mislabeling of the sample. So after all these three analytical variables are checked, the sample is put in the track. So what is a track? Track is a device where after the three analytical variables are ruled out, if it is hospital or multifunctional departments, so the biochemistry, hematology, serology, all the samples will be kept in a single track, and since these are barcoded, the samples will get separated and they will run into their respective machines. After that, depending upon whether there is unidirectional or bidirectional interface, the samples will which are barcoded will run into the system. Once it is run into the system, it will get updated in the interface, that is the lab interface system, and once it is interfaced, it is left to the technician henceforth to look at the reports, look for flags and look for panic values. I'll tell about this in the next slides. So without any delay, the processing has to be done. At room temperature, you can store the samples for 8 hours. If you are storing at 2 to 8 degrees Celsius in the refrigerator, you can store it for 24 hours, but not beyond that. After that, if you run the samples, we are bound to get erroneous results. So all of us know that CBC can be done in two ways: manual blood count, Newborn chamber, which nobody does know, and automated blood count. So automated cell counters. So automated cell counters, they have the principle which is given either by the Coulter, that is the impedance, aperture impedance method, or the light scatter optical method. We have 3-part differential, 5-part, and even the 7-part differential. In 3-part differential machines, we get granulocyte, lymphocyte, and mixed component, which is mixture of monocytes, eosinophils, and basophils. Whereas in 5-part, we have neutrophils, eosinophils, basophils, lymphocytes, and monocytes. So the newer machines, which have 7-part differential, we will get the immature granulocyte count, immature reticulocyte fraction, which gives data about the recent erythropoiesis, reticulocyte hemoglobin equivalent, which gives us information about iron stores, and monocyte distribution width, which we can take as an early marker of sepsis. So why? What are the advantages of an automatic cell counter? It is time saving. There are different machines with different time bound, but most of them will give you the result between 1 to 3 minutes of loading the sample. Then it is accurate, precise, and it saves lot of manpower. So you have to also know about installation of the machine. Once you receive the machine in your laboratory, you should know what is machine installation. So, while doing my machine installation, you need to get the IQ, OQ, and PQ. So, what is IQ, OQ, and PQ? It is installation qualification, operational qualification, and performance qualification. So, what do you mean by that? So, when the service engineer comes to your lab and does the calibration, you need to ask him to show the within run and between run precision, linearity, lower limit of detection, and carryover test. So after all this, you will get the documents of IQ, OQ, PQ. After you get these documents, you need to observe for at least 20 days post installation, wherein you will look for the complete, you look for the precision by running the internal quality controls for at least 20 days. You will do inter-instrument comparison of the harmonization of the machine, and also run the ICAS, wherein you should have no outliers. Then it is fit to use for the patient samples. So what is the quality control check which you need to remember by using the automated coagulation machines?
So it is necessary to ensure the precision and repeatability. After the, you run the quality control, you are going to plot the LJ chart, or the machine itself would have plotted the LJ charts. So you have to use two level of controls at least once in a day. That is for the standalone labs who don't run for 24 hours. If it is 24/7 laboratory or the hospitals, you need to run at least two controls in every 12 hour interval. So please remember this. So two controls, two level controls at least in every 12 hour interval. That is in 24 hours you have to run two times. Maybe once in morning, again once in the night. So once you run, what you are going to check, it should be within the two standard deviation. The normal Gaussian curve, it should be within the two standard deviation. Apply the Westergaard rules. Check for any outliers. If there is any outliers, you have to do the root cause analysis. Whether is there any random error or it is a systemic error. So in case it is a systemic error, you have to call the service engineer. And also always remember, if the outlier is due to a systemic error, you need to check your values or the reports of the previous batch also. Control is not run only to check the next batches, but it is to check the previous batches, what the reports have been released are right or wrong. So if there is any major difference, you have to intimate the clinician or the staff nurse and change the report, re-report it, or ask for a fresh sample and release the report. Then one more thing, you should also always document the CV percentage of the IQC what you have run. The highest CV percentage has to be noted. You have to review it with the because acceptable biological variation periodically, and always make a point to check with the last year CV. It is better to have a lower CV when compared to the last year. And also one more important point in quality check is interlock verification for reagent and control. It is mandatory for both reagent and control before they are put in use. Once you do the interlock verification between the old reagent and the new reagent, for reagent, follow the CLIA acceptability criteria, and for control, you can have a difference of 10% between the older lot and the new lot, or it should be within the manufacturer's reference range. Then, calibration and periodic maintenance is also very important to maintain the good quality of the machine. So, calibration is done during installation. It is done biannually. Preventive maintenance and calibration is done biannually. That is once in 2 years by the service engineers. Compulsory, you have to do the calibration once in 2 years. And also it is indicated, calibration is indicated after any major breakdown of the machine. Like if there is any aperture issues or BSV issues. Then coming to the linearity. So what is linearity? In linearity, you are going to take a known sample, which is usually of the highest value, like, you know, a WBC count of 1 lakh, like that. You're going to take that sample and you're going to put serial dilutions, and you should get a straight line or a straight line curve, or straight line, okay? So that is when you will say that the linearity is acceptable. Nowadays, there are some companies which are having the commercially available like controls. You have the linearity material also. The company engineers itself will come, they will run it, and they will give you a linearity acceptable certificate. So, what are the basic parameters in CBC? It is the hemoglobin, hematocrit count, RBC count, WBC count, differential count, and the platelet. The derived parameters, that is from the HB and RBC count, we get the MCV, MCH, MCHC, and residual distribution width. Then you have the platelet, in that you have the mean platelet volume and the platelet distribution width. Then there are the histograms and the scatter graphs. So these are all the parameters which we see on the window of the CBC machine once we run a sample. So this is what it is. So these are the numerical values. These are the histograms and these are the scatter plots. So how is hemoglobin estimated in the counter? So it is when you mix the blood, there will be you have the lyse for RBC. So once the RBCs are lysed, now we are not using most of the machines are not using cyanide solutions because of its toxic effects. So it is non-cyanide like solutions. After that, you add the sodium lauryl, and either by the oxyhemoglobin method or sulfonylmethylhemoglobin method, the hemoglobin is calculated. Then you have other parameters like RBC count. Okay, and from that you have the, and MCV is derived from the histogram. Then you have the other parameters like hematocrit, MCH and MCHC, which are all calculated values. So this is the RBC and platelet histogram. These are the normal histograms. So you have you know that the size of the platelets, normal platelets is around 8 to 12 femtoliters. And in the platelet histogram, the range will be from 2 to 34 platelets, and for RBCs it will be from 25 to 250, because the normal size of the erythrocytes will be from 800 to 100 femtoliter. And in the normal histograms, you would have a Gaussian curve like this, and it will be touching the baseline, whether it is RBC or the platelet. Then coming to the WBC. So it is based on the Coulter's BCSN technology, that is depending upon the volume, conductivity and the light scatter of the WBC. The WBC is, sample is treated with the, you have one more light, that is the WBC light. So once that is used, it will get light. So after that you get the graph of lymphocytes, monocytes, basophils and the neutrophils depending upon the volume or the size. So this is the scatter plot or the normal data plot, wherein you can see this green, this area is for the monocytes, neutrophils, eosinophils. Here you have few of the basophils. This is for the lymphocytes. And here down, whenever you see any nucleated RBCs, platelet clumps, giant platelets, and few of the machines also give you the indication of malarial parasites. It needs practice. So when it is abnormal, when you see blasts, you will see them in this area, usually in CML, or when you are seeing a shift to left myelocyte and metamyelocytes, you will see it in this area. So one more thing, what you will see in the window of the CBC is the flagging. So it refers to a signal that the specimen may have significant abnormality. So every instrument will have its flagging system, and what is the use of flagging system? You will decide whether to rerun the sample, you will check the integrity of the sample, you will check the integrity of the machine, and also it is an indication to make peripheral smears. So this is one of an example where a sample was run in the CBC machine, and you are seeing that you have L, that is low. This is low. So each machine, whenever the service engineer comes and installs it the first time, they have set the upper limit and the lower limit, below which it will show low. If it is very low, it will show abnormally low. And if it is high, it will show high. So these are the indicators what you see. And sometimes when it is not able to decide, it will give R. That means you need to review the slide. So you have to make the slide for the pathologist to see it. And you have flags here also. So that it is telling there is leukopenia, it is saying it is pancytopenia. Pancytopenia means where there is low WBC count, platelet count and the hemoglobin count. Okay. So or it's saying there is anemia. So again, it is an indication for you to make the smear, or thrombopenia it is telling. Okay. So you should read these flags, you should read this low, high, and also when it says this review indication. So don't get scared when you see all this. So you need to know how to interpret it. So sometimes you will see that WBC, RBC, platelet exceeds linearity. That means there is some issue with the machine, and you need to dilute the sample and rerun the sample. So not issue with the machine, the issue with the sample. That means that's a very, usually it happens in leukemias. Okay, so you will have a count of 1 lakh, or sometimes even we have seen 2 lakhs. So once it reaches above 2 lakhs, you will see that the exceeds linearity. Then you may have to dilute the sample and rerun the slide. Okay. Later you may have low WBC count, for which you need to make a smear. These are all indications. These are not the flags. Okay. Or platelet of less than 1 lakh. The each company can follow, or hospital can have their own guidelines for making the slides. Neonate samples, usually we advise to make a slide irrespective of the values, so that it is cross-checked by the pathologist. Okay. Then whenever there is neutropenia or neutrophilia, then if you get the flags of WBC unreliability, RBC fragments, dimorphic RBCs, all these are indications for you all to make a slide. Or whenever it indicates nucleated RBCs, so or immature cells, sometimes it will say that there are immature cells, so all these makes you an indication to make the slide. So once you are seeing the window where you are seeing the values of a given patient, you see that there are the total count is, for I'm giving you an example, the total count is 2 lakhs. So what is it? It is a panic value or a critical value. So this value has to be immediately informed to the clinician or to the staff nurse, or if it is a standalone lab, you can, if you are not getting anyone else, you can directly call the patient and tell to go for an immediate hospital so that they get treated. So the whom are you going to inform? The concerned person. And once you inform, please make a habit of read back policy. So whether it is the patient you have informed or the doctor, whatever values you have sent on phone, ask them to repeat and kindly document it to whom you have reported, at what time you have reported. That is panic or critical value reporting. It is very important in day-to-day practice. So each, I told you again, each hospital has their own values. So you can, for I mean just giving you an example, so hemoglobin of less than 6 grams or 22 grams, platelet of less than 20,000, WBC count of more than 1,000 or more than 50,000, PTA-PTT is of more than 5, sorry, PTA-PTT of more than 120 seconds and INR of more than 5. When you see any malaria parasite, when absolute neutrophil count is less than 0.5, this becomes very important. In some sepsis cases and also in the chemotherapy where they want to see post-chemotherapy, post-stem cell transplantation, they want to check the neutrophil count. So this is what I told you, the receiving time of the sample, whom it is notified, whether you have done the read back. So after all this, you know the indications to make the peripheral smear. Now my objective is how to prepare the peripheral smear, how to stain it and examination of the peripheral smear. So why will we make a peripheral smear? We want to know the anemia, what type of anemia it is. If there is thrombocytopenia, are there, is it really thrombocytopenia? Are we seeing any clots? Okay, or are we seeing any aggregates? Then are there any blasts or shift to left, any malaria or microphalania? Then any evidence of hemolysis, okay? We get HB of 2 grams, 3 grams. The clinician is interested to know whether there are any nucleated RBC, whether there is any clumping, basophilic stippling. So all these reasons we need to make the peripheral smear and see. So all of you all know there are three techniques, wet, cover slip and automated slide making and staining. So wet technique is the commonly followed. Automated slide making and staining are available in some hospitals wherein the CBC machine is also having the information when to make the slide, so it will make the slide and also stain it. So wet smear, this is a very commonly followed one. Most of us know how to make it. So it is you are taking a EDTA anticoagulated blood. It is in hospitals, it is advised that you do the smear within 1 hour, and you can also use a finger prick sample. So how are you going to make it? You know, all of you all know, you are all fond of the spreader slide. So you, each one of you will have kept the spreader slide aside. So please keep a drop of blood on the edge of the slide, about 2 to 3 millimeter in diameter, the size of the blood drop. And then the spreader slide, it should not have any cuts, it should not have any regular surfaces. And you are going to place the spreader slide at 30 to 45 degrees. And without giving any uneven jerks, you are going to push the blood drop forward. Okay. And what is the shape you are going to get? All of you know it is the tongue shape smear which you need to get. So this is the tongue shape smear what you are seeing. So this is the body, this is the tail, and this is the ideal thickness of the smear where you have to see. This is very thick area and this is very thin area. So good smear, all of you know, is tongue shape, does not cover the entire area of the slide, has both thick and thin areas and has no lines or holes. So why, what are the common causes of poor blood smear, drop of the blood is either too large or small, jerky movements, failure to keep the entire edge of the splenter slide on the required slide, okay, or you have not kept it at 30 degrees, or failure to put the splenter completely across the slide, or irregular spread with ridges. Holes, you can see whenever you are not cleaning the slide properly, when there are some grease or air bubbles. So this is example of few bad smears. Okay, so you can see the edges are ragged, a lot of holes here. Okay, this is because of the dragging. You can see so clearly, you can make out that the splenter has been dragged twice or thrice on the smear. So after you have made the smear, all of you know you are going to air dry it. Okay, after the smear is dried, after 5 minutes of making the smear, you are going to stain it. So how do you do the staining? All of us know it's the Rolaski staining, which is and different types are there, that is MGG, Jenner's, Bright, Lishman and Field stain. So most it's that is Rolaski stains are polychrome stains. It's a mixture of tyrosine and eosinate. How do you get that compound? It is a mixture of methylene blue and eosin. Once you prepare the stain, that is you're taking the Lishman powder and putting it in alcohol, you need to allow it for ripening or the polychromasia. So either you can heat it or you can leave it at room temperature for around 10 to 12 days when the ripening ensures. So after you make the stain, one more important thing is the use of buffer and not distilled water. So when you use buffer, you will get a better differentiation of the WBCs and the RBCs. Otherwise, the stain will be very dull. And one more thing is, you have to have the buffer pH between 6.8 to 7.2. Okay. So the malaria parasites, we usually take the pH of 7.2. And for the regular slides, we use the buffer pH of 6.8. So, Lishman stain. So, what is the powder dye? Most of the small labs will use the ready-made Lishman solution, which is available in the market. But the bigger hospitals will bring the Lishman powder. They mix it with methyl alcohol. So, 0.2 grams of Lishman powder dye. They take it in the tartar and powder it and then pour alcohol and allow it for ripening. Buffer is also prepared in-house, maintain the pH of 6.8 to 7.2. So sodium hydroxide, then potassium dihydrogen phosphate is used and it is put in the distilled water and made to 1 liter. All of us are familiar with the time for Lishman staining, 2 to 3 minutes of the stain and 6 to 8 minutes for the buffer. So, what are the causes for faulty staining? So, when the staining is, why do you get very blue slides? We have seen, right? Blue slides. So, one is it when the eosin concentration is low, when the stock stain is exposed to bright daylight, or when there are some impure dyes, or staining time is too short. Okay, these are, or there is very thick smear or inadequate time of the buffer. You have removed the slide from the buffer very early. Too pink when eosin is incorrect. Impure dyes, buffer pH is too low, or you have kept it for a long time, you have put the slide and you have forgotten to wash it. Okay, then one more common thing what we encounter by seeing the slides is the same precipitate. Okay, so we keep on telling the technicians, please restain the slide. We are not able to make out anything because only stain precipitate is there. So, why is it? Whenever you use an age staining solution, so it is very old, so the stain has got precipitated. So, in those conditions, we always tell the technicians, please filter, use the filter paper, filter the stain and do the staining. Or, one more common reason is inadequate rinsing of the slide. So, what has happened, you have put the stain, then later you have put the buffer, that there is tilting of the slide stand. So, the buffer has fallen down. It has not properly covered the entire slide. So, even in these times, the precipitate is seen on the slide. So, peripheral blood smear examination. After that, after you made the smear, sometimes you need to see the basics of the smear. So, first you will go do for the macroscopic view whether the quality of the smear is good. Is there any precipitates, what I told you? okay, or whether it's very blue, very pink, very light. Okay, after seeing all that, you go for the microscopy. Please start seeing it in the low power, in the scanner. Don't directly jump to the oil power. At the low power, look for the quality of preparation that is sustaining, any agglutination or roulette formation that is the clumping of the RBCs one over the other, or any platelet aggregates. Okay, all this can be assessed at the lower power. Otherwise, you are going to miss these details. Especially platelet aggregation is best seen in the low power. Then you go to the 40X, where you are going to see the abnormal, the normal WBC, if there are any blasts. Okay, and all of you know that a lamination 10 feet you can count, and that into 2000 will give an average WBC count. Next, you go to the oil power, where you will assess the platelets. All this should be done at the junction of the body and the tail. Don't do it in the thick areas. Okay, in there again you check the number of platelets in 10 feet. Its average into 15,000 will give an average platelet count. Look for the atypical cells, what you are seeing, confirm it whether they are blasts or myocytes, metamyocytes, and also look for the malaria parasite at the oil power field. What is the quality check for staying sulfur smear? You have to prepare the Leishman control slide and submit to the pathologist for evaluation. Evaluate freshly prepared Leishman stain, compare it with the old and the new reagent before use and document it. And check the buffer pH daily and document that also. So this is a normal peripheral smear. You can make out properly spread. This is a lymphocyte and a neutrophil. This is a very thin area where you are not supposed to examine the slide. And this is a very thick area. So what is the take home message? So TBC and peripheral smear are very important diagnostic tools. You know how important is the hemoglobin, platelet and the WBC count. So timely identification and intimation of critical and panic value is life saving for many patients. So for that you need to have your good quality of machine. How do you ensure? By running daily QCs, having ICAS, having your calibrations and checking the machine performance. And after that, whenever you make a peripheral smear, kindly follow the rules and make the proper peripheral smear so that it is easy for the pathologist to give a proper and accurate diagnosis. Thank you. So, any doubts anybody has? Anybody wants to know anything further?
You can unmute and my time. Thank you, Dr. Singhal, for an excellent presentation and making it very interesting. Any doubts, you can directly message us, or there's also a comment box. You can message us there also. And also I put up the mail ID. If you want any kind of queries or any kind of doubts, you can directly mail us also. And if anybody who's interested in joining our company, also you can mail us. If any labs who wants to go for accreditation of NADL or any other kind of advisory services, if you want, you can directly mail us. And also our number is also there in the website. You can directly message us or call us also. Again, once again, each one of you present here or during your busy schedule, making your presence in this and also attending the meeting. Once again, I thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Okay, ma'am.
Yeah, I did not attend the meeting.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Welcome.
We'll give the presentation slides, madam.
Yes, sir. You can just message me your mail ID. We'll forward the PPT.
Yes, thank you. Very forward.
Yes.
ఒక్కొక్కరికి ఓకేనా సార్? ఏబిసి డాక్టర్
The recording will also be live on YouTube and by tomorrow evening or something.